a couple of technological tweaks to this wind turbine, and just like that, you could get up to 80% more energy. That would be pretty wild.
Wind energy has been around for centuries, usually like this. When the first actual wind farm came online, it had a peak capacity of 0.6 megawatts. Today, the average wind turbine in the US packs more than 5 times that amount. But unlike solar, which is booming around the world, wind energy has recently run into some turbulent times.
So will these new, taller, wider, optimized to the max turbines help bring wind energy to old glory?
In our quest to harness the wind's power, we've been building ever larger turbines on ever taller towers.
These things are gigantic.
In June 2024, Chinese manufacturer Dongfeng put up a turbine that is 260 meters wide, more than 2 football pitches. And it can power about 36,000 households. Whether on land or at sea, wind turbines only know one direction: up.
Okay, time to bring in the big guns. These rotor blades are definitely bigger. Jesus.
Bigger wind turbines mean more power.
Maybe we need some duct tape here as well. Yeah. Improved wind turbine. It holds and it turns.
Average turbine height has increased by about 150 meters in the last 20 years for 2 main reasons.
The first reason is wind speeds. Typically, you have a lower wind speed at a lower altitude. Doesn't really work, but at higher altitudes, the wind speeds are just way higher. Works better than I expected, to be honest.
And higher wind speeds mean that your turbine spins more and more electricity is produced.
Also, the wind blows more regularly higher, which gives you a more consistent electricity production.
One German company is going above and beyond, literally. They just started to build a 360 meter high turbine. They reckon it can produce 40% more electricity than a regular one.
And the second reason is longer rotor blades.
A higher tower also gives you space for longer blades, and these longer blades increase the area that your wind turbine covers, resulting in more wind being harvested and more electricity being produced.
And this increase is no joke. At the same wind speed, an increase of just 20% in diameter means 44% more electricity produced.
There's a limit to how high we can go, but more on that later. These taller turbines with longer blades also make room for another innovation in the wind energy industry: low wind turbines. Because longer blades cover a larger area, they can catch more wind overall, which lets them start spinning at lower wind speeds than conventional turbines, as you can see here in green.
The fact that you can tap into some hours, start producing at lower wind speeds, means that you can get a bigger revenue because the price of electricity might be higher in those hours.
Mari Münster looked into low wind turbines together with the Danish turbine manufacturer Vestas.
When there is a lot of production of wind power, then electricity prices goes down, which means that your income as a wind turbine owner goes down.
Mari Münster and her colleagues calculated that these turbines can be 35 to 45% more expensive because of extra materials and specifically tuned parts. Yet some projections foresee a big role for low wind production by 2045, if costs can be kept down. With larger towers and rotors, low wind turbines are becoming a possibility, but they're not deployed commercially yet.
For whatever reason, no turbine manufacturer was willing to talk to us about their progress on innovative technologies. But this could have to do with the high cost pressure that the entire industry is facing. We'll get to that in a minute or two.
Let's stick with the big turbines first. As you can imagine, they can't just keep growing forever, because everything would have to grow with the turbine. For example, the gearbox. These wonders of engineering already weigh up to 40 tons. Their job is to transform the massive torque or rotational force of the blades into something more digestible for the turbine's generator. While the rotor shaft turns around 15 times per minute, the end of the gearbox reaches 1500 spins per minute. That way, the generator next to it is able to produce electricity more easily. The problem is that there's a limit to how big these gearboxes can get, as transporting them becomes impossible at some point. So they need to become more powerful while staying the same size. In technical terms, increase the torque density.
When you have a 40 tons gearbox for a 4 megawatt platform, you try to increase the torque density, and then afterwards you have also a 40 tons gearbox, which is able to get a power rating of 9 megawatts.
This is Thorsten Fingerle. His job is to look into the future of wind energy and predict trends for a gearbox manufacturer.
So you can double the power in order to decrease costs and also stick to the limits from infrastructure.
Winergy is looking at two ways to increase the power of the gearboxes while maintaining the same size. One is the bearings.
Back in the past, we used roller bearings, and everyone knows roller bearings might be from bicycle. A journal bearing is simplified to explain a ball bearing without the ball. You take the balls out of the bearing and then you fill in a really, really thin lubricant.
This film of oil is thinner than a human hair. This saves a lot of space in the gearbox and makes it more powerful. The other innovation targets the different stages within the gearbox and allows them to handle bigger loads, aka stronger winds. This also means that the size and capacity of turbines can increase without needing bigger gearboxes.
For the next 10 to 15 years, I'm quite optimistic that the race for even higher power ratings will go on. Especially the innovation pressure from China is in this direction to have even bigger power ratings.
And the size isn't just a problem for the gearbox. As you can imagine, transporting these rotor blades that are longer than one football pitch can be quite a challenge. So people came up with an idea, breaking these blades apart.
Right now, rotor blades are usually produced in one piece in giant factories. Breaking them up into sections could make them easier to transport, but also easier to repair. The connections are either bolted or they can be permanently bonded with glue. But these connections lead to overall design challenges.
Especially if you think about the bolted connection, you have some metal pieces somewhere quite outboard at a high length of the blade, which is lumped mass at a position where you don't want it.
This is Enno Petersen. He investigated how feasible it is to build segmented blades.
It leads to high bending moments and also loss of the energy yield. And I think this is one of the biggest reasons or the biggest challenges.
And of course, this whole process costs more than just having your blade in one piece. According to one calculation, around 20% more, but it would only reduce transport costs by 5%. And it's not just the costs that are challenging. Putting these blades back together on construction sites isn't easy either.
In the field, you would need quite a good workshop to do that, and it must be mobile somehow.
Meaning it's quite difficult to move the assembly out of a factory where you can control everything onto a construction site. Because of these extra costs and technical uncertainties, blade manufacturers like the Danish LM Wind Power told me that they aren't betting on segmented blades as of now. Also, for other innovations, such as welding towers together in a special way to reduce transportation costs or climbing cranes which would help reduce construction costs, it was hard or impossible to get an understanding of how much cheaper this would make it to build a turbine.
And this leads to one of the biggest challenges for the wind industry when it comes to these technical innovations right now: cost pressure.
Costs within the wind industry have risen sharply since 2020. Take one of its main components, steel. Since the COVID pandemic, the price has increased by more than 50%. According to consultancy Wood Mackenzie, the costs for one turbine have hiked similarly by 20 to 40%.
The wind sector is facing the perfect storm, as it was not only the steel prices that escalated, but also all the other commodities, logistics, labor, power prices, interest rates as well.
This is Andre Liko. He's Wood Mackenzie's principal analyst for wind technology and has also worked with manufacturer Siemens Gamesa.
As a result, the leading Western OEMs have lost more than 12 billion from 2020 to the first half of 2024.
Also, costs for other building blocks like nickel, manganese, copper all went up.
One of the main problems is that it takes a long time to build wind projects. Getting permits, manufacturing the parts, and setting up the turbines can take years. The recent changes have hit some manufacturers so hard that they've been cancelling or pausing entire wind farm projects.
We have not gone through all the turmoil. We are still seeing that prices of the turbines are not retreating. And we're not expecting on the onshore at least to retreat in the next 12 to 18 months.
We're getting taller towers, longer blades, higher capacities, and a few other things. This certainly unlocks new areas and potential for wind energy. But the really hard to answer question is how much exactly and how quickly? Because before developing new standards, adjust the supply chains, etc., 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 many industry players will be more focused on getting as much money out of their current technology as they possibly can. If you did like our experiments, which were of course very much true to reality, please like the video, comment on it, share it, and don't forget to subscribe to our channel. We post new videos on the environment every Friday.